আসসালামু আলাইকুম, আমি বিপিন সাহা, সেক্রেটারি IEEE ইউনিভার্সিটি অফ রাজশাহী স্টুডেন্ট ব্রাঞ্চ। আজকের এই ওয়েবিনারে আপনাদের সবাইকে স্বাগত। আমাদের আজকের প্রোগ্রামের টাইটেল অটোনোমাস ড্রাইভিং ফর কনস্ট্রাকশন ভেহিকেল। আমাদের সাথে অনারেবল স্পিকার হিসেবে যুক্ত আছেন সম্মানিত দীপঙ্কর দাস স্যার। উনি বর্তমানে জাপানের তয়োহাশি ইউনিভার্সিটি অফ টেকনোলজিতে অ্যাক্টিভ ইন্টেলিজেন্স সিস্টেম ল্যাবরেটরিতে রিসার্চার হিসেবে কাজ করছেন। স্যার আমাদের রাজশাহী বিশ্ববিদ্যালয়ের ইনফরমেশন অ্যান্ড কমিউনিকেশন ডিপার্টমেন্ট ইঞ্জিনিয়ারিং ডিপার্টমেন্টের একজন সম্মানিত প্রফেসর। আমাদের আজকের এই ওয়েবিনারে দেশের 51টি শিক্ষা প্রতিষ্ঠান থেকে মোট 254 জন অংশগ্রহণ করার জন্য আগ্রহ প্রকাশ করেছেন। এর মধ্যে 58 জন IEEE মেম্বারশিপধারী আমাদের সাথে যুক্ত হয়েছেন। গুগল মিটে স্থান স্বল্পতার কারণে এবং অনেকের অনুরোধে আমরা এই ওয়েবিনারটি আমাদের অফিসিয়াল ফেসবুক পেজ IEEE ইউনিভার্সিটি অফ রাজশাহী স্টুডেন্ট ব্রাঞ্চ থেকে লাইভ টেলিকাস্ট করছি। অনারেবল পার্টিসিপেন্টদের উদ্দেশ্যে বলছি, আপনাদের কিছুক্ষণের মধ্যে চ্যাট বক্সে একটি ফিডব্যাক ফর্ম দেওয়া হবে, সেখানে আপনারা ইভেন্ট সম্পর্কিত আপনাদের মতামত জানাতে পারেন। এছাড়াও আমি আপনাদেরকে অনুরোধ করব আপনাদের মাইক্রোফোনটি বন্ধ রাখতে, যেন সবাই নির্বিঘ্নে এই সুন্দর ওয়েবিনারটি উপভোগ করতে পারি। আমাদের অনারেবল স্পিকার প্রেজেন্টেশন শুরু করার পর যদি কারো স্ক্রিন দেখতে সমস্যা হয়, তবে ডান পাশে স্যারের প্রোফাইলের উপরে ক্লিক করে স্ক্রিনকে পিন করে নিলে সমস্যার সমাধান হবে বলে আশা করছি। আপনাদের কোনো প্রশ্ন থাকলে তা চ্যাট বক্সে জানানোর জন্য অনুরোধ করছি। এ পর্যায়ে আমি চলে যাচ্ছি আমাদের অনারেবল স্পিকারের কাছে, তার থেকে অটোনোমাস ড্রাইভিং সম্পর্কে জানতে।
Okay, can I start?
Yes, sir, you can start now.
So at first, I would like to share my screen. So share the entire screen. Choose what you like to share. Sorry. Are you able to see my screen? Are you able to see my screen?
Yes, sir. No, sir.
Yeah?
No,
no,
sir.
Sir.
No, sir.
No, sir.
No, sir.
No, sir.
So the sharing option is visible. Hi.
Sir, you can share by clicking the present now option.
Present now, yeah. I start from present now option, sharing the okay. So now, are you able to see my screen?
Yes, sir, we can see your screen.
Okay, so good afternoon, everybody. Okay, good afternoon, everybody. So all of you are seeing my screen?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
So I will start now. So I want to present some research area for autonomous driving. Especially, I will mainly focus the autonomous driving for construction machine or construction vehicles. About myself, I think that the IEEE student and secretary already introduced me, so I skip this one. So my presentation is divided into three sections. At first, I will introduce about my research institute and research lab. I will briefly introduce it. And then I will discuss the autonomous driving system for regular vehicles. At first, I will discuss the autonomous driving system for regular vehicles. And then I will discuss about the autonomous driving for construction vehicles. This is the main theme of my of today's lectures. So let me introduce my research institution. Toyoshi University of Technology. Actually, the Toyoshi University of Technology is a very good place for engineering and technological research. The university consists of five departments, only five departments: mechanical engineering, electrical and electronic information engineering, computer science and engineering, applied chemistry and life science, architecture and civil engineering, and Institute of Liberal Arts and Sciences. If any one of you want to research on engineering and technology, I think in Japan this is a very good university for research in engineering and technology. I am belonging to a computer science and engineering department. Under the computer science and engineering department, my name of my lab is Active Intelligent System Laboratories. There are various kinds of research done in this laboratory. In my lab, Active Intelligence System Laboratory, the head of the lab is Professor Jun Miura, and then in my lab, an assistant professor, and we are three researchers in our lab. 25 students, including MSc and BSc students, and 6 foreign students in our labs. In Active Intelligence System Laboratory, we are conducting various kinds of research, including intelligent robotics. In my lab, we are developing an attendant robot. This kind of robot is able to identify a specific person and then track the person with the specific target or a specific task. We are also researching in localization and mapping. This is very much important for mobile robot to traverse around an environment. For this kind of mobile robot, it is important to create a 3D map using a sensor like LIDAR sensor, light detection and ranging sensors. This kind of sensor and we use to create three-dimensional map. And this three-dimensional map is very much important to navigate the mobile phones. We are researching life support robot. That means this kind of robot is very important for home assistant, especially for disabled or elder persons in a home. So this kind of robot is able to take care disabled or elder person. And we are want to developing this kind of robot for helping the disabled person in home. It can also used for home care system. For example, if the older person is forget to take a medicine, the robot can remind him for a predetermined time. Human robot interaction is another research topics in my lab. Here the human and robot collaboratively do the task. For example, for searching a specific object, the human and robot can collaboratively help for the specific object. The human robot interaction can be also used for assembly a product. Another broad area of research in our lab, Active Intelligence System Laboratory, is the harvesting robot that is in the field of agriculture. In our lab, we are developing a robot that can harvest vegetable or fruits from a garden. So there are many persons are involved, currently involved in this kind of robots. So these are the main topics of research we are currently conducting in our laboratory. So now I will focus on the today's main topics, the autonomous driving. The autonomous driving, it can be classified into two broad categories, autonomous driving for regular vehicles and autonomous driving for construction machine or construction vehicles. At first, I will discuss the autonomous driving for regular vehicles. This kind of vehicle, the autonomous driving for regular vehicles, is also known as a self-driving vehicles, autonomous vehicle, driverless car, robocar, or robotic car. This kind of car or vehicle is capable of sensing its surrounding environment using different kinds of sensor and move safely with little or without human intervention. So it was expected about 10 million autonomous vehicle will hit the road by 2020. And within 10 years, we can move to the fully autonomous vehicles. The autonomous vehicle will targeted to generate the 7 trillion annual revenue by the year 2050. So it is a huge amount of revenue. And wide spread adaptation of autonomous vehicle could lead to a 90% reduction of vehicle crashes. So the research towards the autonomous vehicle is clear how the autonomous vehicles is important for us. So this is a video for autonomous vehicles. So you are aware that the autonomous vehicle is available in the market. This is a Tesla car. So the autonomous vehicle combine various types of sensor to perceive the surrounding of the environment, such as radar sensors, LIDAR sensors, sonar sensors, GPS sensor, odometry, and inertial measurement unit, IMU sensors. So this kind of sensors generate a lot of data, and this of sensory data is processed in a computer and then control the car based on the observation of the data. So the level of autonomous driving is divided into five categories, mainly five categories. The level zero is no automation. That means this is a manual car, level zero, no automation. So no steering or acceleration or deacceleration can be controlled by automatically, cannot be controlled by automatically. Man will control all or everything within the car. This is the manual car. Then level one, autonomous driving. That means this kind of driving is known as driver assistant car. So here, any one of the function can be done automatically, either steering or acceleration or deacceleration can be done automatically. However, the monitoring of driving environment and fallback when autonomous fails will be controlled by the drivers. So driver need to sit behind the steering. That means only one function can be controlled automatically. Then the partial automation, level two automation. In level two automation, both steering, acceleration or deacceleration can be set in automatic mode. However, the monitoring of the driving environment and the fallback when autonomous fails will be controlled by the human drivers. So level two automation, we still need to sit back behind the steering. So some mode of automation can be controlled automatically. Then in the level three automation, this is known as a conditional automation. So in this case, in addition to steering or acceleration and deacceleration automation, we can also monitor the environment using different kinds of sensor. That means the car can see the environment using sensors. So the automatic braking system, automatic accelerating system, automatic steering system, automatic environmental monitoring system can be done in conditional automation. So if driver want to drive by his own, he can switch in manual mode in conditional automation. However, some form is automatic in conditional automation. Then the high automation, high level of automation, level four automation. Actually, we are currently in this level in autonomous driving. What we are hearing or what we are seeing currently, the high automation levels. That means the steering, acceleration or deacceleration can be done automatically. Monitoring of the environment, it can also be done automatically. And recovery from the when the automation fail can be done automatically. So in high level of automation, the car can automatically move in a road, and the driver can take relax, or he can give her attention to another things. For example, in a cell phone, he can do anything. The car will move automatically. However, in this kind of automation, level four automation, we have to control some things. That means the road will be specially designed for autonomous driving. The lane and the road sign will be clearly visible from the car. So although the high level of automation exists in the current level of automation of the car, however, it is not fully automatic car. In full automation, we are expecting the car will automatically move anywhere in the world. So this kind of automation is not available now. So what is the progress of autonomous driving? From where we start the thinking of autonomous driving? In 1948, the introduction of cruise control, the concept of cruise control is introduced in 1948. However, in 1999, the main function on main research for autonomous driving is begin here. And Federal Communication Commission allocates 75 hertz of spectrum for dedicated short distance communication for the autonomous vehicles. In 2007, DARPA challenges, then we done DARPA grand challenges for autonomous driving begins. And a project completed in 2007 by DARPA. In this case, the self-navigation car complete a 60-mile distance automatically. However, this is conditional automation. This was the conditional automation. This was not full automation. Google Waymo, the most common autonomous car for the Google Waymo, the Google began her project in 2009. For autonomous driving car. And Google autonomous car completed 14 miles of driving test in Nevada state of America in 2012. Mercedes and Infiniti began her research for autonomous driving in 2013. And NHTSA, National Highway Traffic System Administration, released initial policy on autonomous driving. What will be the policy implication for autonomous driving? The American National Highway Traffic System Automation, they provide a policy for autonomous car. In 2015, Tesla released autopilot self-driving mode. This is also the level 3 automation. And Uber has 40 Carnegie Mellon researcher to work on an autonomous driving car. And the Ford began testing its self-driving car in 3 states, California state, Arizona state, and Michigan states. In 2016, major acquisition of partnership, GM Motor and Cruise Automation, GM Motor and Lyft, Toyota, and Joybridge Robotics, Uber and Volvo, they combinedly research on autonomous driving. In 2017, NHTSA issues revised safety guidelines. What will be the safety rules for autonomous car or autonomous vehicles? They provide a revised version of the safety guidelines. And they also issue guideline for testing and deployment of autonomous vehicles in 2017. Uber relaunched a handful of cars in 3 cities in 2018. So this is also partial automation or high level of automation. And autonomous driving for construction machine also available in 2018 in some form. So what are the current state of autonomous vehicles? We are not yet at the point where fully autonomous vehicle is available. So we are not in full automation mode for vehicles or car. However, we are quickly moving towards that point. And it is expected that within 10 or 15 years, we can reach at this point. That means full automation for vehicles. However, the lower level of self-driving an AI system, artificial intelligence system, already have been present in our car, recent development cars. This kind of AI and self-driving system is available. So the main component by which the car see the environment are the heart of the autonomous car. And these are different kinds of sensor, as I told in my previous slide. I will now discuss in details about these sensors. One of them is GPS sensor, global positioning system. Another is light detection and ranging, LIDAR sensor. We can also put the high definition video camera, ultrasonic sensor, a radar sensor, and a central cameras, a central computers. So this kind of sensor and control system is situated within a car, in autonomous car. So now I will discuss this kind of sensor, the function of this kind of sensor. At first, LIDAR. The LIDAR is the main component by which the car can see the environment. Actually, the LIDAR sensor will construct the 3D map, three-dimensional map of the environment. And based on this map, three-dimensional map, as can be seen here, three-dimensional map, the car can move from one place to another. So this is important part or important sensor, LIDAR sensors. LIDAR sensor, light detection and ranging. It is mainly use the laser light emitted by the sensor. And this laser light is fall on the surface of an object and reflected from the object. Based on this time of flight, that means time of flight of the light, it calculates the distance of an object. It can see the object in an environment. So this kind of LIDAR sensor is mounted on the top of the car. Especially it is designed on a rotating motor, and the sensor is rotated on the motor. Another sensor is the radar sensors. We know the radar means radio wave detection and ranging. So the LIDAR and radar, the function of these two sensors almost the same. However, the LIDAR sensor has a high accuracy. In car, to see the environment, we use multiple sensors for more reliable map. So we also use the radar sensor. The radar sensor is mainly used the radio waves. The radio is emitted from the antenna of the sensors. And this radio waves is reflected back and received by the receiver antenna. And based on this flight of time, it can detect the object. So radar sensor can work with other sensors, such as inertial measurement unit. And this kind of radar sensor is mainly placed on the bumper of the car. Two sensors in the front bumper of the car and two sensors in the rear bumper of the car. Another sensor is the ultrasonic sensor. Although this kind of ultrasonic sensor has a very narrow field of view, and short the effective range, approximately 6 meters. However, it has an important function. It can be mainly used the sidecar, the car moving around or going through the side, or it this kind of sensor is placed on the wheel of the car, and it is also important during parking of the car. When we park the car, it is also important to detect the side object. So ultrasonic sensor is placed or situated in a wheel of a car. Cameras, high definition camera, high definition video camera is also used in a autonomous driving cars. And this kind of camera is mainly used to detect the traffic light, road sign, and the lane, road lane of the cities or of the road, and look out also the pedestrians and obstacle, and also the peripheral movement and dimensionality of the object. So this kind of camera, high definition camera, is very much important for autonomous car, especially for detecting the traffic light and traffic signal. So based on the traffic light, traffic signal, road lane, lane sign, the car will move automatically. Another is the GPS sensor. The GPS sensor, global positioning system, is an important, and with the help of other sensor, this kind of GPS sensor is mainly used to detect or triangulate the position of the car using satellites. The positioning system works alongside the onboard cameras to process the real world information as well as GPS data. So this kind of GPS sensor accurately determines the precise position or location of the car. So GPS information is very, very much important for autonomous moving of the car. The heart of the autonomous car is the central computer or control unit, where all information, all sensor information, all information from different kind of sensor are processed. This central computer is a high configuration computers. They need to process the data in real time, because the sensor of an autonomous car produce a huge amount of information per second. So this kind of information need to be processed in real time. So we need a very high definition computers in an autonomous driving car. So this kind of computer processes the data in real time, as well as modeling the behavioral dynamics of other drivers. It not only model the autonomous car we are currently in, it also also model the behaviors of other car or other pedestrian on the road or roadside or object around the car. Some data based on the processing of the central computer, some data are hard coded. For example, when the red signal see the car will brake automatically. The car will stop. So this kind of decision is very hard and hard coded. However, in other response are learned based on the previous driving experience. So every driving mileage, the car gather a huge amount of information, and based on the previous information, the car will learn, and the car will determine, and car will provide a new solution based on the previous data. So the number of mile the car completed is by the autonomous car is important for learning data. The learning algorithm processes the data, and not just the car you are riding in, But this kind of autonomous car also process the information of other driving behaviors, other cars. They also collect the information, the behaviors of the other car. And this kind of information is also processed by the autonomous car. So what are the main challenges for developing an autonomous car? One challenge is the technology. We need very rich technology for autonomous driving, because the car will see the environment based on this sensor. So this kind of sensor will be highly accurate. This kind of sensory information will process real times. So we need a high level technology to be processed for autonomous driving. Another thing is the government regulations. What the government thinks, whether they will permit the autonomous driving or not. So this kind of mentality of the government is important. Another is the policy implication. What policy need to be implemented for autonomous driving? For example, the road sign will be clearly visible. The road lane will be clearly visible. The signal will be, road signal will be visible from the car. So this kind of policy implication is an important for the autonomous driving. Another things, what the customer is thinking. The customer want to move in autonomous mode or not? Because it can be sometimes some people enjoy the driving, so they cannot move to the autonomous mode. So this four things is very important for autonomous driving of a car. So what are the potential advantages of autonomous car? The autonomous car is able to avoid traffic collision caused by human driver errors. So if we implement all the technology accurately, then this kind of collision, this kind of accident can be reduced by autonomous car. The autonomous car is able to increase roadway capacity and reduce the traffic congestion to reduce the need of safety gaps and ability to better manage the traffic flow. This is another advantage provided by autonomous vehicles. Relief of vehicle occupants from driving and navigation duties. So if we move to the fully automatic mode, then we need an extra seat for a driver. So this seat can be allocated for passengers. Higher speed limit. So autonomous driving will move in a limit provided by the road sign or highway. So speed limit is strictly controlled by autonomous cars. Most of the, for example, most of the accident in our current world is because of the high speed, they cross the speed limit. So this kind of speed limit can be highly controlled by autonomous car, so accident can be reduced. Removal of constraint or occupant state, so it would be better. It would be not a matter if the occupant were underage, the occupant, while the driver is overage, the driver is unlicensed, the driver is blind, distracted, drunk, or other impaired. So this is no matter for autonomous vehicles. Another thing is reduction need for traffic police and premium on the vehicles. So if the accident can be reduced, then the premium for the insurance for the vehicle accident can be reduced also. And traffic police, the functionality of traffic police can also be reduced. The reduction of car theft because vehicle increase the high awareness and high security in autonomous vehicles. Also the car sharing is important. So Uber are thinking this kind of business. They eliminate the driver, the car will automatically move from one place to another. Only the car can be used their app and it will move automatically. So alongside with the advantage, there are some disadvantages of autonomous driving. So driver's re-education, the new apps need to be learned by the drivers. The cost of implementing the new technology could be way out of the reach for the most of the people. Especially the lidar sensors and different sensor and high configuration computer cost more for the autonomous car. So currently thinking this kind of autonomous vehicles can reach the out of the general customers. Another is the security issue. So hacking of different application, different apps, different control system, this is an important part for autonomous driving to move into the automatic mode, the security issue and location-based information. So another issue is the loss of job, taxi drivers or drivers of the Uber systems, driving school, automobile companies, not in autonomous production, traffic board, and other things. A self-driving car does not completely eliminate the likelihood of a car accident because the malfunction of the networks, the software corruption, the weather related information, and other circumstances, the sensor cannot be work accurately. For example, the lidar sensor cannot work accurately in bad weather. So this kind of consideration need to be think about the alternative sensors or more improved sensors. Heavy reliance on technology make it difficult to function their absence. So the autonomous driving system is based on different signal and sign, especially for road signal, road sign. So if the road signal or road sign is not clear enough to see by the autonomous driving car, then the autonomous driving, it is very difficult to do works by the autonomous car. Another things, as I discussed in previous, the most of the previous slide, the most of the driver who enjoy the autonomous driving cannot move in autonomous mode. So now I will discuss or focus the main theme of my today's lecture, autonomous driving for construction vehicles. So this is the main topics, the main research area, that means what I am doing on autonomous vehicles. So now I will discuss. So the construction equipment or construction machine is mainly indicate the highly heavy duty vehicles, especially designed, this kind of vehicle is specially designed for executing the construction task. For example, the crane or excavator or this kind of equipment. For example, this is an autonomous excavator. this kind of construction machines do his task automatically. So the construction equipment or construction machine can be categorized into three categories: earth moving equipment, construction vehicles, material handling or material handling equipment or machines. So I will mainly focus the material handling equipment or machine or vehicles because we are specially designing a crane system that can work automatically in a construction site. So the material handling equipment mainly used for transportation, storage, and control at any stage of the processing of materials, and we can be classified into different categories such as crane, conveyors, hoist, forklift. So among them, I am specially interested in a crane. So this kind of, we are very much familiar, this kind of construction crane. A crane is a type of machine generally equipped with a hoist rope or wire or shapes. And this kind of crane can be used both to lift or lower materials and can move horizontally. So the construction crane can be classified into different categories. Carry deck crane, this is a mainly versatile and mobility crane. They can be used for loading or moving materials on job sites. Another type is crane, and most widely used crane is the crawler cranes. In crawler cranes, they use the wheel. Truck wheel, crawlers mainly use the crawler for wheels, not a rubber wheels, crawler wheels. So this kind of crawler wheels, this kind of crane is able to work in a soft or terrain environment, uneven terrain environment. Another type of crane is the floating crane. So in floating crane, we can see this kind of crane in a sea area or in a river. They are able to work in a water and mainly used in sea area and in port area. Another type of crane is a raft crane for rubber wheels, but using this wheel, they can operate in a very rough terrain environment. Another type of crane is a truck mounted crane. Truck mounted crane has the ability, it is almost the mobile crane, and it is mounted on a truck for loading or unloading the materials in the truck. Bridge crane. So reliability and stability and efficiency of this type of crane is very much effective. This kind of crane is mainly seen in the industrial area. Bulk handling crane, large garbage-like mechanism can be handled. In mine, we can see this kind of crane in mine area for coal or scrap materials. Hammer head crane, this kind of crane has the ability for trolley to move back and forth and use in construction project. In construction site, we can see this kind of hammerhead crane. Stacker crane, forklift-like mechanism. They can lift a cartoon in an industry or lift some object in a warehouse or move some warehouse. So another type of crane is the telescopic crane, hydraulic cylinder, where hydraulic cylinder is used for changing the length and highly adaptable for variety of mobile situations. Another type of crane is tower crane. This kind of crane is can be seen in a high-rise construction site, multi-storage building. We can see this kind of crane, tower crane. So among this kind of cranes, we are working on a crawler cranes. Crawler cranes, that means the crawler cranes mainly use the crawler instead of wheel and working around the world to meet all kind of material handlings. This is a very common crane in the world. And can be seen in almost every construction site, this kind of crawler cranes. So construction site as well as in port area, we can see this kind of crane. This is a mobile crane. This kind of crane can be shipped from one place to another on a car for work in a construction site. So we are working with the Kobelco company. This is the Kobelco crawler cranes. And we actually want to this movement of the crane in autonomous mode. So we are actually working with the Kobelco company. So this kind of crane can be seen in most of the construction site, and it consists of a vertical structure. This vertical structure is mainly known as a boom of the crane, this vertical structures, and it has also a load line. Load line is hung by the rope or chain, and the crane also has a crawler wheels, and the load is adjusted here. So depending on this load placed on the crane, the ability of the crane can be increased or reduced. So we are working with this crawler crane with the Kobelco company. So when we ask for autonomous driving of this crawler cranes, so we mainly plan the path or plan the motion or scene recognition in the working site of the cranes. So we developed a different type of function, we recognized different kind of function. That means one is the safety functions we need to be developed, need to be considered in a construction site. This is very important. So we need to develop the collision alert and emergency stopping system. in a construction site. Another is the operation assist. So collision operation assist, when the crane will operate or help or assist the operation, it will also need to detect the collision and alert the systems. Obstacle detection and visualization of occulted area, and bird eye views. That means views from the top of the system, from the sky, view from the sky. And another is the automatic operation. For automatic operation, for autonomous driving of a construction vehicles, we need to implement the automatic operation. That means route and plan, motion planning, and finally, user interface design. For this three types of functions, we divide the total function into two broad categories. One is the local area recognition, another is the global area recognition. And this kind of recognition task will be done through different kind of sensors. So in the local area recognition, we mainly recognize the surrounding of the crawlers. That means wheel, surrounding of the wheel or the crane base. In the surrounding of the crawler, there may be human, there may be car. So we need to detect the surrounding of the crawlers. We also need to detect the surrounding of the suspended load. That means where the load will be suspended by the crane. There may be building, there may be human. We need to detect this kind of objects. We also need to detect the surrounding of the boom area. That means boom will move, crane boom will move. So we need to detect the surrounding of the boom area. The surrounding of the boom area may be buildings, may be power lines. So we need to detect these things. So we identified this kind of recognition as a local area recognition. Another is the global area recognition. In global area recognition, we need mapping and danger map. So from the sensor data that can be collected by a sensor, we need to develop a 3D map, three-dimensional map. This is very important for any kind of autonomous movement, for autonomous vehicle, regular vehicles, also as well as for autonomous construction vehicles. We need to detect this kind of, we need to recognize this kind of map. And in our case, this map will be generated based on the omnidirectional high density 3D lidar. In local recognition, we can use the wide area real-time 3D lidars. And normal camera, but in mapping and danger area recognition, we use the omnidirectional high density 3D lidars. We also need to plan the motion, how the movement of the crane will be performed. We also need to plan these things. So our whole function is presented here, how the autonomous cranes or autonomous vehicles will work. So at first, we collected the data from the construction site. So from the construction site, we collected data using 3D lidar sensors. On the right side of the slide, this figures shows the point cloud data, PCD data, mainly point cloud data collected by the sensors. So the data visualization after collected by the lidar sensors. And this kind of 3D leaders, from the data of this kind of 3D leaders, we are able to construct the 3D map. However, there are some problem we facing when we collected the 3D data using the LiDAR sensors. Normally, the rotation axis of the sensor and the scanning plane must be parallel. If they are parallel, the rotation axis and scanning plane, then there will be no problem. However, this is not all time, this is not the case. So we are finding there is a gap between the scan plane, indicated by the white ellipse. There is a gap. Or if we see the right side of the data, so this two kind of plane is deviated by an amount. And we need to correct this kind of plane. So to correct or modify this error, we have used the iterative closest point algorithm. This algorithm mainly iteratively apply the move the plane and calculate the closest point. That means P1 will map to the red P1, P2 will be mapped to the red P2. So this kind of mapping, we iteratively applied and determined the closest point. And after applying this process, we are able to correct the data. We are able to join these two planes correctly. After correcting the data, we generate 3D map in an outdoor environment. So before 3D map, we need to register different scan. That means we want to register two scan, first figure and second figure. We want to merge. So we need registration technique. For this kind of registration, we use the normal distribution transformation eigomotion motion algorithm for registration of these two planes. After registering, we use the SLAM technique for constructing the map, simultaneous localization and mapping technique to construct the map of the outdoor environment. And our system is able to construct the three-dimensional map for movement or motion planning accurately for this kind of algorithm. This kind of map detection, we use the SLAM, simultaneous localization and mapping. This is a very, very much common technique for generating 3D maps. So we also calculate the distance from the crane to the suspended load location using the collected data of the 3D LiDARs. And this distance is important because the crane will move so and forth among two points. Another safety restriction, within a construction site, we need to detect the human for possible collision or possible safety. So we use the 3D shape model for detecting the human in a construction site. And our model is currently able to detect the human. Some static human detection is available, but we use the LiDAR sensor data in the lower left of this screen to detect the human accurately. and dynamically. So every person entering into the system is correctly detected by our human detection algorithm, and it is able to track the human. This is very much important for moving the crane in a construction site, because we need to detect the human. So our human detection and recognition algorithm is able to detect this human. Currently, for high density scanning, 3D scanning in a construction site, we introduce another sensor. The sensor is a six lidar sensor. This sensor, the sensor has a plus minus 120 degree rotation angles. It can be rotated plus minus 120 degree maximum. And the angle resolution is 0.2 degree. And it can be rotated at a speed 10 degree per second. The dimension of the sensor, outline dimension, 260 by 260 millimeter. And the weight of the sensor is approximately 9 kg. So you understand that this is a very heavy weighted sensor. So for our scanning, we put this sensor from top of the crane. We hang the sensor from top of the crane using the rope. The sensor is hanging here, and you can see the sensor, the crane is moving into a scanning using the sensor. So we are thinking this sensor will be placed in a crane. So after scanning, we collect the data in a construction site. And this is an example of a data that we obtain from these sensors. So we obtain this kind of data. This is an example for different angle of view, different rotation angle. We obtain this kind of data, 3D data, from the sensors. This is the another example from another view. We obtain this kind of data. Actually, in the very beginning of this year, when I joined to this lab, I had given this data, and you can see there are some problem of this scanning data. Are you able to see? I think that you all are see the problem of the data. This is a wall. This is a smooth wall, but the scan data is in wavy in nature. Wavy in nature. This is a rooftop. This is the rooftop of a building. But scanning, this should be smooth rooftop. But this rooftop has also in wavy in nature. So when I join in this lab, I was given this data, and the head of this project asked me, you need to correct this data. That means you need to remove this webinar from the data. So I start my research from here. How this webinar can be removed from the data? Because so at first, I need to detect why the data produced by the sensor are in wavy natures. Why smooth plane are in wavy natures? Because the sensor is hung from the crane, and the weight of the sensor is approximately 9 kg. The sensor is swinging. When the sensor is scanning the plane or scanning the construction site, the sensor was in swinging nature. So due to this swinging nature, the data was collected by the sensor was not smooth enough. So data is in wavy form. So actually, this swinging nature of the data changes the pose, angle of view, 3D pose of the sensor. Changes the 3D pose of the sensors. And if we want to remove this wavy nature of the data from the data, so we need to correct the pose. We need to determine the change of the pose and correction of the pose. So this is not an easy task. So when I was given this data, he told me, if it is done by an algorithm, it will be a great achievement for us. So sensor will produce, sensor will swing, sensor will sense his motion, sensor will move. So we will correct the data. So for this purpose, at first, I determine the actual pose of the sensor. And depending on the pose of the sensor, if I am able to determine the pose of the sensor, then I am able to correct this data. So I was finding how the sensor pose can be optimized, how the sensor pose can be optimized given some constraint. So now I will discuss this algorithm in details, how the sensor pose can be corrected and the sensor pose can be optimized. We are given some constraint. So my algorithm for data correction is divided into several steps. At first, we are given the original point cloud file, original point cloud. That means the data generated by the sensor. This is the original point cloud file. From this file, we remove the NAN and we fit the plane. Then we construct the pose and optimize the pose. And based on the pose optimization, we modify the original point cloud data. So I now this steps I will discuss in details for your easier conception. I will not go through the mathematical details. I will discuss in visually. I try to discuss in easy way. So from original point, this is original point cloud data. You can see that data is in wavy nature. From this data, some point exceed the range of the sensors. So this point is indicated in the point cloud data by not a number, NAN data. So at first, we remove the NAN data from the original point cloud file. Then, from this original point cloud file filter data, we fit plane. We can see here two kinds of plane exist. One is the horizontal plane. The plane is the ground plane. The sensor see the ground from the top of the crane. This is known as the ground plane. So at first, we extract the ground plane from this data. That means we segment the ground plane from the data. That means the point that belongs to ground, actual ground. So from the point cloud data, we separate or segment the ground. For this purpose, we use the random sample consensus algorithm. This algorithm is mainly used to fit the model. For example, plane fitting, for line fitting, we can use this algorithm. So in my case, I use this algorithm to fit a plane. We fit horizontal plane, ground plane, and we also fit the vertical plane. This plane, this is a vertical plane, wall plane, wall like plane, the plane that is in webbing nacelles. And the ground plane also in webbing nacelles. We can see this is very smooth, the extracted plane. However, if we see in details, then we can see this data also is in webbing nacelles. So if data actually belongs to the ground plane, then the point should be belongs to the ground. But due to the movement of the sensor, sensor swinging nacelles, this data, the scan data, was actually not belongs to the ground. In the bottom of the figures, this data should be smooth. This is a wall, so smooth wall. So if the sensor is not swinging, this data should also be in smoothness. However, the sensor is, since the sensor is swinging, some data points hit to the walls and some data points not hit to the walls. So this webbingness exists. So at first we extract ground plane and extract the wall plane. We construct a graph based on these two kind of planes. The wall plane can be more than one plane. There may be many vertical plane, but we extract only one ground plane. For each ground plane, in this case, for each frame in the scan video or scan stream data, for each frame, we add to the graph a node. And this node is known as a post node. That means for each frame, scanning frame, we represent a node of the graph. This node is known as a post node. For example, if there are 500 frame in our scan data, then there will be 500 post node. And within each post node, there is an edge, E1, E2, EN. This kind of edge is known as the post edge. So we represent this node using the post matrix and edge using some measurement value. So I will briefly discuss what the measurement value will be later. So for each frame in the scan data, we add a node. This node is known as the post node. And for each plane, we also add a node to the graph. For ground plane, we add a ground plane node. And if ground plane belongs to each frame in the post node, then we also add an edge between the post node and ground plane node. If ground plane also belongs to the frame number 2, then we also add another edge between the ground plane node and the post node. So in this way, we add ground plane edges. If there are n ground plane frame, then we add n-gram beryllium is. In case of wall plane is relatively smaller for this, for our case, we see that not all frame belongs to the wall plane. So which plane belongs to the wall frame, we add another node between the wall plane node and host node. And these two node is known as the constraint of the graph. So in the post graph, the plane node will be represented by the plane coefficient. For each plane, we get a coefficient of the plane. So plane node will be represented by the plane coefficient, and plane, for plane measurement, yes, that means plane edge will be represented by the measurement noise. So here is our technique. For measurement noise, we want to minimize the noise. That means we want to minimize the distance between the point to the plane. If we are able to minimize the distance between the point and plane, then the plane will be smoother. So in this post graph, we actually minimize the distance between the point and plane using these edges. And for this minimization, we modify the post. Initially, the post is initialized to identity matrix. All post node is initialized to identity matrix. And based on the minimization of the distance between the plane points and plane, that is the distance between the plane point and plane, we modify the post. And if this distance is tends to zero, we are assuming that we are correctly determining the post. So in real world situation, it is not possible always to minimize this post to zero. However, we will determine, we will want to determine the post approximately zero. And the plane will be, if we able to minimize this error approximately zero, then the post will be updated, and this post information can be used to correct or modify the PCD point cloud data, and we will get the optimized plane. This is an example. So in my previous slide, this plane can be seen in web ingressors, but after using my technique, it is almost seen to smooth ingressors. So web ingressor has been removed from the data. So we want to see how this method is effective. We experimented our system in a simulated data. So real world data, there may be different factors can work. So we use the Gazebo environment. Gazebo is a open source 3D robotic simulators that can be used in a simulation environment for simulating different kind of robotic systems. We use this Gazebo environment for simulating data. This is a Gazebo environment. We create a wall. We create another apartment. We create different kind of object. And this blue line indicates a sensor, ray sensor. And we swing this sensor. And when we swing this sensor, this sensor should generate the plane wall. This wall should be plane. This ground plane should be plane. However, this, because we swing the sensor, we obtain this kind of data. This is the OAB data. So this OAB data, you can see that this plane is not smooth. This plane is also not smooth. Ground plane is also not smooth. So we apply our algorithm on this data. And after optimization, we obtain the smooth earth data. So this is the point cloud data before optimization. And the right side shows the point cloud data after optimization. So our algorithm is correctly working. We are able to eliminate the smooth wave inserts from the data. So if we able to add more plane to the graph, then the data will be corrected more accurately. So here we add another plane. This two is the wall plane. This three is the wall plane. And one is the ground plane. And after optimization, using two plane, we obtain this kind of result. However, using three plane, we can get more smooth earth data. So multiple plane will gives us more smoother data, more smoother plane. So after optimization, we able to identify this kind of structure, small structure from the data. So in summary, the additional plane gives us more accurate results. Large plane gives more accurate results also. Threshold of the plane extraction has an impact on the optimization result. So this is the plane extraction. You can clearly see that the ground plane is in purple color. However, ground plane included some other plane because due to the threshold value, we set higher threshold value. That means 0.2 plane distance, 1.2 meters. So it include more other points. So it can be successively reduced using the reducing the threshold value. So we also experiment with successive extraction of the plane. There are four plane. One is a ground plane and three wall plane is added and move the sensors. And we obtain this kind of OAB data. And after optimization, we successively add the plane. At first we add the ground plane and then we add the wall plane one. Then we add the wall plane two. Then we add the wall plane three. Successively correct the data and add to the post graph. And it can be shown that it is more effective if we add the plane successively. A small correction of data, then extract another plane and add to the post graph. So this kind of successiveness search of the plane can accurately smooth the plane and eliminate the wave inserts. So you can see the plane can be more accurately determined. And after different iteration, we can get more smoother and smoother results. And finally, we are able to extract some small structure from the data. This kind of structure can be recovered from the data. So in summary, successive addition of plane gives us more improvement to the result. So it gives us more opportunity to detect more plane, able to recover small structures of object. So currently we are developing the crane in a Gazebo environment to simulate the crane construction machine in Gazebo environment. For this purpose, we construct the crane using the physics rule. We also add a sensor. This blue line indicate the ray sensors, and we add different kind of plane, different kind of structures, and these ray sensors scan the plane by moving the sensors. It scan the 3D data. That means 3D data is scanning by the sensors. And after a complete scan, the sensor is swinging. You can see this sensor is swinging by small amount. This is due to the nature of the pendulum, almost pendulum kind of nature. So we obtain this kind of deviated data, and we are able to apply the post optimization technique to remove this wave nature. So I am almost end of my presentation. So I actually discussed two kind of autonomous vehicles, autonomous for regular vehicles and autonomous for autonomous driving for construction vehicles. I also discussed a algorithm. So for autonomous driving, it is very much important to implement the safety, security and privacy. This is very much important. Safety measures should be taken for the autonomous driving. Liability of accident should be clearly identified. Who will be liable after accident of the autonomous driving, autonomous vehicle? It will be car company or the owner of the drivers. So it should be clearly identified. The security of potential attack should be identified and implement in autonomous driving, such as electronic control unit, ECU. There are some ECU, and this point, this unit can be hacked. So we need to implement a security algorithm on this unit. Onboard diagnostic port, we need to implement a security system. Dedicated short range communication based receiver, we also need to implement a security system. Software glitches, where is the software? We need to implement a security system. And different kinds of apps. Apps has also a vulnerabilities in nature, so we need to implement the security algorithm. And we need to data privacy. So every car is moving, the car owner has a privacy. So we need, for example, the location information should not be disclosed to everyone. So this kind of privacy technique should be implemented. So the area of improvement, where we can research in autonomous vehicles. In autonomous driving, there are several area of research. You can research in a lidar sections. You can research in a control area. You can research in a navigation equipment area. You can also research in driver assistance systems. So enhance the vehicle system for safety and improve driving. For driver control, technology that include blind spot detection, pedestrian detection, lane detection, intelligent braking system, traffic sign recognition, automatic braking system, adaptive cruise control system. You can do research in this area. Telematics. Telematics is include telecommunications, vehicular technology, road transportation, road safety, electrical engineering, computer science, GPS technology, DSRC, vehicle to vehicle communication, vehicle to infrastructure communication. So there is a vast area of research in this area. In AI area, for improvement of autonomous vehicles, we can research in this AI area. AI is very important. Artificial intelligence is very important for fully autonomous vehicles. The vehicle should be learned from the previous data. So we can research in this area. We can also research in GPS area. Current GPS has accuracy in few feet levels. So we can improve this accuracy in millimeter levels. So in GPS area, we can also improve the autonomous vehicle system. Dedicated short range communication, DSRC area, vehicle to vehicle communication, vehicle to infrastructure communication. We have also facilities to research in this area. LIDAR area, LIDAR is very important sensors for autonomous driving, and we can improve more efficient, more accurate sensor, more reliable LIDAR sensors. So in conclusion, actually in our lab, we are working with Kobelco company, construction company, and we are developing an autonomous vehicle for construction crane. So far, we have developed most of the software components. So currently, we are testing this software in a simulation environment. And after simulation environment, we will define the user interface for autonomous vehicles. So this is all of my today's presentations. So thank you very much for your attention. And now it is open for a discussion, open discussion. If you have any questions, please ask me.
Thank you, sir. আপনার এত সুন্দর একটা প্রেজেন্টেশনের জন্য আমরা অলরেডি চ্যাট বক্সে বেশ কিছু কোশ্চেন পেয়েছি, তো আমি সেগুলোকে একটার পর একটা আপনার কাছে নিয়ে যাচ্ছি। Shahriyar Hussain question question. Sir, what sort of cameras are used in autonomous cars, like IP cameras or FPV cameras?
Actually, the high definition camera, video camera are currently using in stereo camera is using in a autonomous vehicles because we need to detect clearly detect the road sign, the lane of the road, the traffic signal. So currently using the high definition video cameras and as well as stereo cameras for depth information.
Istiak Zahur, good question, sir. What do the autonomous car will be electrical cars? If so, what it will do when the fuel or electricity run out? Because in the case of human, we can see the warning and rush to the charging system.
In autonomous vehicles, there are some alarming systems. When fuel will be reduced by some amount, they will alarm to the apps. They need fuels. So as soon as possible, you recharge or fill up the fuels. So this alarm systems, as if like our cell phone, they will give alert to us.
Okay, we got another question from Shahriyar Hussain. What sort of algorithms are used for human detection?
Human detection, this is depends on the developers. So currently different kind of shape, human shape recognition technique from the LIDAR sensors or from video cameras we are using. So this kind of shape recognition algorithm is currently using for human detection technique.
আমাদের কাছে আরো একটি কোশ্চেন এসেছে ইব্রাহিম খলিল অপূর্ব, তিনি কোশ্চেন করেছেন, স্যার ফর টু পার্সন ইন কলিশন এন্ড ইন ডাইনামিক মোশন, হাউ ডু দা 3D লাইডার ডিটেক্ট দেম?
এক্স্যাক্টলি, ইন ডাইনামিক মোশন দা কলিশন ক্যান বি ডিটেক্টেড ইজিলি বিকজ উই এবল টু ট্র্যাক দা পার্সন. And in my slide, you can see that if you are able to track the person, you can easily detect the collision. So this is very much important to detect and track the person. So this slide
In this slide, our algorithm, 3D shape recognition algorithms. So this kind of bounding box, you can, I don't know if you are able to see or not. The human is recognized in a bounding box. So the collision of two humans is easily detected if bounding box overlaps by some sort and from the depth information.
Thank you, sir. We got another question from Ibrahim Khurib Apurbo. Can we use LiDAR sensor in the wheel in place of ultrasonic sensor so that we can get more range for detection?
Actually, for wheel, we need not very larger range sensor. So LiDAR sensor, currently developed LiDAR sensor has a very large range. So in wheel, we need to detect very short range sensors. So here is the ultrasonic sensor is enough. But in case of environmental, since the environment, we need to detect a long range of data. So in this case, we use the LiDAR sensor as the main sensor for environmental tracking. However, in case of wheel, actually we don't need, I think, very large range sensors. It is enough for a very short range sensor, such as a sonar sensors is enough.
That's all, sir. আমাদের কাছে আর কোনো কোশ্চেন নেই। এই পর্যায়ে আমি আমাদের ভাইজিপলি ইউনিভার্সিটি অফ রাজশাহী স্টুডেন্ট ব্রাঞ্চের সম্মানিত চেয়ারপারসন হোসেন মোহাম্মদ সাবিরকে অনুরোধ করছি কিছু বলার জন্য। সাবির, ক্যান ইউ হিয়ার মি? সাবির, সম্ভবত টেকনিক্যাল ডিফিকাল্টির কারণে কোন একটা সমস্যা হচ্ছে, আমরা একটু ওয়েট করি। আচ্ছা, সম্ভবত আমাদের চেয়ার টেকনিক্যাল ডিফিকাল্টির কারণে আসতে পারছেন না। যাই হোক, আমি স্যারকে ধন্যবাদ জানাতে চাই, আসলে অসংখ্য ধন্যবাদ জানাতে চাই এত সুন্দর করে অটোনোমাস ড্রাইভিং এবং এর রিসার্চ এরিয়া সম্পর্কে আমাদের টপিকগুলো বুঝিয়ে দেওয়ার জন্য। এরই সাথে ধন্যবাদ জানাচ্ছি আমাদের IEEE ইউনিভার্সিটি অফ রাজশাহী স্টুডেন্ট ব্রাঞ্চের অপারেশনাল টিমকে, তারা এত সুন্দরভাবে এই ওয়েবিনারটি উপস্থাপন করতে পেরেছে। সাথে আমাদের পার্টিসিপেন্টদেরও অসংখ্য ধন্যবাদ, আপনাদের অংশগ্রহণই আসলে ওয়েবিনারটিকে সুসজ্জিত করেছে। আশা করছি পরবর্তী ইভেন্টগুলোতেও আমরা আপনাদেরকে পাশে পাবো। এক্ষেত্রে আমি আরেকটা কথা বলতে চাই যে আগামী 14 তারিখে আমাদের আরো একটি ওয়েবিনার আসছে। আশা করছি আজকে এই রাতের মধ্যেই ইভেন্টটি আমরা আমাদের ফেসবুক পেজ থেকে পাবলিশ করতে পারবো, আপনারা সেই ওয়েবিনারও আমাদের সাথে থাকবেন। এই মুহূর্তে আমি সবাইকে অনুরোধ করব আপনাদের ভিডিও অন করার জন্য, আমরা একটা স্ক্রিনশট নিতে চাই, গ্রুপ ফটো অ্যাকচুয়ালি।